So we can eat by meditation and learning how to do crosslinking too. So that was kind of fun. Okay? So we've got about maybe one more minute. One more minute. So this is just a problem. So this is a very simple way I'm going to show to cure your problems on you. Okay? Really, really simple. If you can do this, and you can do this in surgery, you can do this. No sweat or anything. All right? All right. You want to go?
Yeah,
let's go. Let's go.
I don't need to introduce Jerry to all of you, but I'm really wondering how simple the simplified cases are. So.
Anyway, thanks for coming. It's been a crazy meeting for me, but this is something I want to share with you all. And when you get your first ectasia or keratoconus coming in, then it's going to be kind of fun for you. Now, keratoconus and post-infective ectasia are actually very similar. Okay? If you look at this, you can see what is the difference. If you look here, this is ectasia, and this is keratoconus. So, not much difference. You look at the roof front, not much difference too. So, why are we treating things differently? We should actually treat things exactly the same way. Oh, yeah. I'm really completely no disappointed. Okay, so let's start with post-resective surgery ectasia. Now, I say resective surgery because Lasik has a bad name. We all know that this is a case I did. And a risk factor I forgot to mention is always this. Okay? When you do doctors, and I do a lot of doctors, that's a big risk factor. So anything that will go wrong will occur in doctors. So this is post-Lasik 2012 and 3 years later. If you get past 4 years, usually nothing happens. It's always in the first few years you get it, and it's never in the beginning. It's always around 4 years. So when you see something like this, your heart starts to go a little bit faster. And you say to yourself, oh boy, what are we going to do for this patient? Now, smile is not something to smile about. And that's from Randallman. So, go to work ectasia. Quite a lot of it actually. And here, and here, and here. Yeah. Now, ectasia after Lasik. Look here, and you can see the major problem is coma. Basically, it's just coma. Now, you can see here as well, over there. You can see that elevation, posterior elevation, and you can see where the apex is. Now, anything that decentered from the center will give you coma. So it's very easy to treat this kind of patients if you have a shim. Now, this is typical. You can see the epithelium is relatively over the cone. So everything matches. It looks exactly like keratoconus. Okay, or early keratoconus. So, basically, how I start, I do a corneal refund measurement. That means I do a corneal topography. You can use a scalp, you can use a CS. Both are their advantages. I'll go through a little bit about that later. But you always start us putting everything at zero because you want to see what is the minimum amount of tissue you have available that can take care of your coma. Don't start putting it sphere and cylinder. I'll tell you about that later. Later you can do something like that. So zero, and it prompts you only higher order aberration because coma is a higher order aberration. Now, we go to manager, okay? There's manager button one. And this is a full corneal refund treatment. Now, if you look here, 158 microns. How can you do 158 microns? Kill the cornea. Okay? Now, what you do is you do that. One button, one click. So far, you've done the same thing. You put it in, you put the laser, you put it in zero, whatever you want to put it in. Later, I'll tell you how to do sphere and cylinder. And then, you take this off and you calculate. Now, it's dropped down quite a fair bit. Okay? So, let's see. Yeah. Now, if you look here, okay, maximum ablation in the center, here is 75. Now, remember, you are 55 microns of epithelium. So I'm actually taking 20. That's it, 20. But now I have some bugaboo with the sheet paper, because they should give us the number here. So I have to go with the mouse and click it over here and you tell me how many microns. I'll go and click it there and tell me how many microns. But I don't really care because this here, 124, is up there. Now we all know that the cornea is very thick in the PC, correct? So 125 microns in the PC is not a big deal. Anyway, the epithelium is also thicker. So it's around 60 to 65. So nothing to really worry about, because if you take this and that, and then you end up with it. And this is not zero. This is actually 0.75, 0.75. And I'll talk about that later. But if it was zero, it's even thinner. Okay? Now, so here we are. Trans PRK. PRK. Now, I cannot think in trans PRK. I will always switch to PRK. So basically, I want to see what's going on underneath the epithelium. So here we are, 22 microns over here. Epithelium is like a masking agent. So I'm very safe, 22 microns I can afford. I can give it to you. Because I'm going to do full cross-linking after this. Now, with the latest software, for those of you who don't have the latest software allows you to change. This is the default 55. You can change it to lower. You can go from 40 to 75. So you can change your epithelial thickness depending on what you find. Okay? Now, what you don't want to do is you don't want to do this because you waste this amount of corneal tissue. Okay? You also don't want to do this because you don't treat enough of the cone or the ectasia. So you need to get it just right there. If you take too much, you're wasting tissue. If you take too little, you're not doing enough treatment. So it's a fine balance, okay? Now, as a rule of thumb, for you, those of you who don't have a CS, later I'll show you what the CS can do. If you don't have any other way of checking the cornea other than a scout, half here, half in there. That's the starting point. And I see how much I need to do. Now, a lot of these cases, especially if you catch them early, very intense here, mostly cylinder. But the cylinder is actually coma. The brain thinks that coma is cylinder because the optician will put cylinder on the glasses. And that's the only way you can correct coma. At least the optician, that's the only way they can correct. So how much do you actually put in for cylinder? As a general rule, start off with half sphere, half cylinder. Okay? Now, if you have the CS, do this. You go to wet, put it there. You took it and you do foreign dissolution. This is a foreign method. Now, why do you want to do the foreign method? Because you want to see how much is astigmatism and how much is coma. So you can tell this is astigmatism and this is coma. Now, this is one keratoconus case. Now, let me show you another case. See, that is astigmatism and that is coma. So you can have an idea how much of it is coma. So this is a lot. This is 2 diopters of coma. So if you start putting in astigmatism, this is 1 diopter, and your infectionist tells you 3 diopters of astigmatism. And you punch into the laser, 3 diopters of astigmatism, and it's treating coma, 2 diopters, what are you going to get? You're going to get an over-treatment of your cylinder. It's going to swing it the other way around. Because We don't have coma glasses. I wish somebody would make coma glasses. You put coma into the glass and ask the patient what you see. But the problem with coma is that they have direction and it depends on the position. So it's very hard to make glasses for coma. But this is interesting. Let me show you one again. Very important point. Here, see? This is astigmatism. That is coma. This is, by the way, the right and the left eye of the same patient. So in one eye, he has more astigmatism. On the other eye, he has more coma. So this will help you decide, am I going to put in astigmatism into the correction or not? Okay, if you have enough corneal tissue. Now, what is enough corneal tissue? Now, how many of you do 100 and my corneal flap is 105 microns? Who is around 100 microns? 100, 105, right? Now, let's say 55 microns is for epithelium, correct? Now, what's left? About 50 microns. 50 microns is in the flap, the stroma. So are you weakening the cornea if you are thinking of the flap? You are not. So I can easily give away 50 microns. Easily. If the flap was thicker, let's say it was done by an old microkeratome, 160, then I have 110 microns to play with. Yeah, wonderful. I can do more things because the flap is not producing any strengthening. You're only worried about the stroma. Now, please remember that the stroma, when you cross it, there's another factor you must consider. The stroma you consider, you must be enough to do full cross in G. Now, with the available system, you can go down to 320. For the Brisbane protocol, it's 400. Actually, I cheated on the Brisbane protocol. You just swell up the cornea. You all know how to do that, right? Hypotonic, riboflavin, swell it up and do the cross linking. All right? So that's how much of depth of ablation you're allowed. Think of the flap thickness, and then you know how much you're allowed to go. So it varies depending on the cases. Okay? So this is the case, that, and that after that. So you can see the coma from here disappeared. Look at that. From 1.7. I always think in darkness. I cannot think in microns. So for those of you who think in microns, I apologize. I think of it in darkness. So we went from 1.79 to 0.44. Any way you see red turn to yellow. Of course, ideally it will be green. But yellow is better than red anytime. When you go through a red light, you get a $200 fine in Singapore with 4 points, okay? You go to a yellow, you're just scolding, and that's about it, sorry. Now, so this pre-post. Same thing just showing you. Now you can see here, this is another case. From 2.2 down to 0.44. Even the threshold has come down. So this is what happens. So your patients get from here to there. So there's a lot of difference for the patient because ectasia or keratoconus always occurs central or paracentral. In fact, mostly paracentral. I just show you the same cases, that's all. Now, I did a few cases, non-trans-TRK, and this pre-ectasia, post-ectasia, and then post-PRK, ACXL, pre-PRK, PXL. You can see I managed to get a 13 diopter drop, which is a huge amount, just by treating the coma. Now, trans-TRK or non-trans-TRK. The epithelium always makes the apex of the cone flatter. So if you take off the epithelium and treat the cone, you are going to treat less because it's more gentle. This thing is sticking out more. So I think the best thing to do is to do trans-TRK. So I did a few cases of it. So comparing left and right eye, same patient. This and this, this and this. This one is PRK, not trans PRK, and this is trans PRK. So trans PRK did better than non-trans PRK. That means I didn't scrape off the epithelium, I just laser it on the cornea. Keratoconus. Now, this is keratoconus. This is after treatment. If I show you this, would you think this is a keratoconus case? Nobody would believe it. This is the same patient. He went from here, look at that, to there. Still not perfect, but better than before. Now, this is the thing I do. I print out my sheet. I press my button there, and that takes me 123. You don't notice that, 108. So that's different because what you're lasering on the cone is not what you're lasering in the center of the cornea. So for the SCHWIND people, who's listening for the SCHWIND people, please put a number for us here so that we will know how much you're taking from the apex of the cone. And then I put another number up here. I take one. So I know how much I'm taking. Okay? Now, what happens is that if you do a full corneal refund, the danger is that this is spherical aberration. Now, a lot of keratoconics have very negative spherical aberration. They are very prone. So, they are very prone. You don't have to do anything to them. So, it leaves the spherical aberration out. That's why it works by taking off the spherical aberration. Just take off the spherical aberration. Now, you see this? This is spherical aberration filtered. So I click off the center and that's my treatment. It's very, very simple. One click of the button and that's your done. Trans PRK, click the center button, spherical aberration, and it's going to get rid of your cone or get rid of your ectasia. Okay? Don't do anything to the spherical aberration. Don't do anything to the periphery. What you want is you want the treatment over the apex of the cone, and that's it. You don't want to do anything else. So that's full corneal refund. That's it. Corneal refund spherical aberration filter. This is a keratoconus, quite a severe one, 53 for one, and then you see one after the treatment. He's elated. Even though it's not perfect, it's a lot better than before. So here we are. Now, look at his spherical aberration. It's a negative spherical aberration. So why are you fussing around with spherical aberration? Just leave him alone. Don't touch his spherical aberration. This is his other eye. I did a full corneal refund. Spherical aberration, almost nothing. When the spherical aberration is nothing, don't do anything to it, just leave it alone. So leave it alone when it's negative, leave it alone when it's a small amount. But if you see this as a very large number, what's a large number? Anything over 0.4 is a large number. Cut it off. Okay? You can leave it if it's less than 0.4, but I do it standard. I take off for everyone. I just take it off for cases where I want to treat a central problem. A central problem is a problem where you just only want to treat the center. You don't want to do anything in the periphery. Here we are. Another case. Look at that. 12 diopters of distance. That's a huge amount for a little bit of corneal tissue. How much did I remove? 60 microns, 50 microns around there. And I got 12 diopters of effect, 14 diopters of effect. So, yes. Oh, you can shrink the optical zoom as small as you like, so long as you cover the cone. So 5.5, 6, 5.3, 5.8. Anything so that you mark out your zone to cover the whole cone. Not half the cone, but the whole cone. So it saves even more tissue. Very good question, Jared. Now, I still want to keep it around there because you can always swell up the cornea to do your crossing too. If you are doing the discipline protocol, if you are doing my window accelerated, you can just go ahead. 3 to 5 is safe, very, very safe. Why? Discipline protocol strengthens your cornea much more than, I would say much more, more accelerated crossing too. Okay? The demarcation line is deeper in the discipline protocol. So if I have to go really, really strong cornea, I'll use the discipline protocol. If I find that the keratoconus is an early one, I'll use the accelerated crossing tool from Ovidio. Now, standard crossing is also not. Now, this style case is beautiful because you are removing the dormant layer. You know how fast your rubber filling goes into the cornea? It's amazing. It really sucks into the cornea very quickly. Hypotonic, yes. 10 minutes, no problem at all. The thing is this. A lot of doctors leave it to the staff to put. I sit there and talk to the patient for 10 minutes. And I like to put, and even though the girl tells me, 2 minutes, I say, one extra drop won't harm. Put another drop in. No big deal. Because I'm sitting here anyway, so I just put it in. What's the difference between a lot of riboflavin and no riboflavin? A lot, because there's no cross-linking if you don't get enough riboflavin. I'll tell you a little secret, okay? Now, you can, all of you can make your own riboflavin, okay? So I don't know whether I should tell you this. Riboflavin is for injection, right? It comes in little vials. You can actually use it neat on the cornea. I've done that. What do you mean by neat? You can actually just put it pure on the cornea. Nothing happens. No, I keep it. Because you don't have to do it. If you have done a myopic correction, the cornea is already flat. You don't want to do anything. If you start to do something to it, what happens is that it will get more flatter and you get a hypermetropic treatment. This way, you only want to treat the very center. You understand what I mean? So you can do it once more. Please cover the cone. Enough to cover the cone. The ablation must be able to cover the cone. And then you can use your scalp or your series to measure yourself manually. Oh, it doesn't matter. You just cover the thing. Even if it's on the outside, the epithelium, nothing really much happens to the epithelium. So, now, this is something I'm always asking to do for me. You know, in 1 meter, corneal infant, okay? You'll come out of the ablation, then the next one will filter off the spherical ablation, next one will minimize. And this is a technique we tell you to do, which is very confusing for me. So we ask you to do this. And for me, this is another technique I do to adjust for the overcorrection you get in spherical aberration. Okay, so this one is something that, a subject of another talk, okay? No, this one is not zero infection. This one is some infection. If you do a zero infection, you can also get a similar pattern as well too. It doesn't matter, so long as you have it all displayed out. Yes. Oh, you add an infection after you see whether you have enough tissue. Now, if you don't have enough tissue, and you put zero infection in, that's it. That's the only way you can treat the coma. Forget about the sewer. Forget about the cylinder. I tell the patient, you're going to have a better quality of wound, but you still need to wear glasses. But if you have enough tissue, now I'll tell you another secret. Not necessarily if you put in sewer and cylinder, you get less corneal tissue removed. I still haven't found a way to predict it. But if you put in 0.5 in sewer and cylinder, sometimes you actually get less corneal tissue removed. So you start to play with it, but then you end up spending like 5 hours on one case. You try 0.5, 0.5, and then you see. Then you try to take the circle, the cylinder in. Then you say, I get less tissue and I'm going on like this, and my whole brain is covered with printouts. All marking out all the spots, and then I get confused at the end of it, and I say, I don't know what, and I start again. But anyway, basically you can actually see sometimes the sphere and cylinder actually reduce the amount of adhesion tissue. But I didn't want to tell you all that, but it can be done. Yes. Yes. No. These are all exactly the same. All exactly the same. Oh, all are same is actually this is a. Oh, yeah. You minimize the depth. Minimize the depth. I didn't inside. I minimize the depth. There's a minimized depth function. Okay. Let me put it this way. This is sense and here. His brain. And I'm very sensitive to relinquish my brain to sense brain. So I do all these calisthenics to try and remember this. Okay? My hope is that you can do this automatically. That means you put in one thing, all the screens come out, everything from you, and then you look at everything, and then it can be done, it's automatic, it should be done automatically. Okay, thank you very much. Any questions? As a question, who has ectasia here? I mean, who has had ectasia? Nothing wrong, I have five. So, ectasia. Ah, good. When you have ectasia, this will come in really useful. Because you just do something simple. You take off the cervical ablation, leave the coma, and the rest of the higher orders, and you're fine. Really? And then after that, you can start playing with the sphere and cylinder. And as a general rule, I tell you to put it in half sphere, half cylinder to start off with. If you have the CS, look at the cylinder and then adjust. And then don't be frightened if you cannot treat all the sphere and cylinder. That's not the purpose. In fact, I find these type of cases very easy because you are not guaranteeing a perfect result. You're guaranteeing case one, his cornea is stronger, two, the shape of his cornea better, and therefore his quality of vision is better. So this will help. And if you beat all your competitors, you don't know how to do this. Okay? So simplify the very chance. Are there any questions? I use two types of protocol. In a very severe case, I will still use the BCM protocol. 30 minutes, and all the usual stuff. If I find there is an early case, let's say for example, the early cases that I showed you, then I will use the video because it is much shorter, much more comfortable for the. Exactly how I will earn towards the decent broker, but it is a really early case, no problem. I'll give you that. Okay. Now, I cannot give you a figure, a number. You say, okay, I switch. This time I switch, every time I don't switch. I think a good number to remember is probably anything above 50 doctors, I will probably go with Muslim protocol. And below 50, there is a really early cases, the firm fruits cases, I will do. Let's say you catch a firm fruits and you're watching him everywhere and suddenly he started to change. I will do it immediately for that patient. And I will do this because he still has enough corneal tissue. I will tell him that I will try to make your vision better. And if he's a very low myope, better still. Okay? They are highly hyperopes. They are mostly myopes. I have a few keratoconus that are hyperopes. Those are different ball game altogether. But they are very, very mostly myopic. Another question? I do know that I'm seeing all of you. My hope is that I just my addressing.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for your time.
Bye.
So, yesterday.